Well, hi everyone, I'm Andrew Miller and this is Idea Dispenser. And today I want to talk about what reading literature can tell us about interaction design. Specifically, what Herman Melville and Moby Dick might have to say about the different ways that designers and users view the same systems, applications, websites, and devices. There's something that's been hard for me to explain when I'm teaching a class or talking to people about what I do as a designer and researcher. And I think I finally found a way in. So bear with me through the literary theory, and then we'll get quickly to stuff that you can apply either as a designer or as a user. So I need to tell you about two famous authors. One is Herman Melville, who wrote the first real great American novel, Moby Dick, which is about the journey of Captain Ahab to finally get revenge on the whale that took his leg. And Borges, who was an author and philosopher who's known for many things, the Borges story I want to talk about today is called The Library of Babel. And in this story, Borges imagines a library that has every possible novel. This is very similar to a theory you might have heard where if you gave monkeys and typewriters enough time, they could type out the works of Shakespeare. Very similar. And it's useful as a philosophy exercise because embedded in that library is every novel that we know about, but also versions with slight differences. So maybe a typo here and there, maybe the character's name is changed from Ahab to Larry, and you will find all of those different variations of every single novel that's ever been written. So I was reading an article on Medium the other day by novelist Robin Sloan, and I'll link that in the description, about a story that he read called The Librarians in the Branch Library of Babel. And this is a story about a branch library of Babel that only has part of the collection. They've got everything that could be considered part of Moby Dick. They might have one with maybe some of the whaling chapters removed. There's a bunch of chapters about the business of whaling that don't really move the story forward, but are still part of Moby Dick. They might even have ones with sex scenes, and there's none of those in Moby Dick. And they might have ones with alternative endings. And this story was trying to explore, where do we set the boundaries? We know that Moby Dick with typos is still Moby Dick, and we know that Moby Dick where it's a turtle instead of a whale is not really Moby Dick anymore. So this story asks, who gets to decide what is really the essence of Moby Dick? So what Robin Sloan talked about was this feeling that he's experienced this during the creation of one of his most recent novels, sharing versions of the book with friends and family with entire characters or sequences or themes that never made it into the final book. And he questions whether he's even in the place to tell whether those versions would be in the branch library of Babel devoted to his book. I think this idea gets at something that anyone who creates a work that's meant to be consumed by people can understand, which is, it's not entirely clear who owns the essence of a creation that you make. Is it you? Is it the audience? I would say that it's a combination of you and the viewers, or the users, or the readers. But neither the author nor the reader really has full control over what we would consider part of the work. In a novel, this is not so strange. Or this doesn't really come up a lot because the book is published, maybe it has a second edition that corrects errors, or maybe the ebook gets updated, but generally the novel stays the novel. And if you want to explore the world further as an author, you write a sequel. When you're designing software or hardware with a software component, you can actually go ahead and perform revisionist history. An easy example of this is the iPhone. So the iPhone came out with only one screen of apps. Those apps were all made by Apple, and they had a very sort of skeuomorphic or realistic look. Well, fast forward to 2014, you can't run iOS 7 on the original iPhone, but you can run it on something that's sold today as an iPhone. It has a number of differences. It's thinner, it actually takes up less volume, it's got a larger screen, and the software itself has a number of things that were never in the original iPhone, primarily the App Store, and it looks totally different in terms of the aesthetic that the iPhone had. There are fewer naturalistic cues, and there are a lot more expert things, so you can sort of slide down to perform a search or stuff that's hidden. But it's still an iPhone and it's still iOS. And the way that we've gotten here is by improvements over time, adding features, adding functionality, and a discussion between the designers of the iPhone and the consumers of the iPhone. And they've both had stuff to say about it. That's a situation where the designers and the consumers or users are in accord. But it doesn't always work that way. Facebook, in particular, has had a lot of difficulty persuading its users to move with it as it changes what it means to use Facebook. The newsfeed is the classic example of this. There was no newsfeed in the original Facebook, and when it was introduced, people really complained that it seemed sort of stalkery, that it was a violation of their privacy. And now, when Facebook is dealing with newsfeed overload, that is, there's just so much that people you know on Facebook do every day that they can't show you everything. So they've been trying to make changes to that, and people want the full control back again that they didn't think was really a Facebook-style thing in the beginning. I think this approach of thinking of the designers as librarians and the users as patrons of the library, trying to decide what should show up in the library that is your project, the soul of your project, helps explain why you've got these challenges sometimes. And I think if users and designers could think this way more often, there might be more agreement than there is today, and there might be a greater level of understanding. So I think there are two implications. For designers, it's important to remember that although you made the thing, you don't really own the thing once you put it into the world. And especially if you're issuing updates, or it's a service, or it's something that you're continuing to iterate on, you and the original idea and the users of your system are all involved in shaping what it really means to be that system. And you don't have the final say. And for users, users think of your stuff as very static and unchanging, much like the library appears to be static and unchanging. So if you're a user of a system, remember that that system was made by a very small group of people. It would shock you to know how few people produce the things that you use every day. And know that when they release a feature, there is a reason behind it, and they consider it part of the umbrella, part of that branch library, that is the system or application or device that you're using. And once you know that, go ahead and give them a piece of your mind. All right, that just about wraps it up. Please let me know if you're enjoying these, if this particular lens helps you in any way either explain to friends and family or understand yourself. Go ahead and like this video, subscribe, I post every 2 weeks, and leave a comment and tell me what you think. All right, thanks.